One of my interests is alternate numbering systems. I've talked about them in a few videos, but one thing I haven't really talked about in a video yet is my original method for giving names to numbering systems. There's a full description of the system that's been on my website for years at this point, but given that I'm currently simultaneously working on like 5 distinct video projects, and I don't think I'll get any of them done in time to be the big video I put out for this month, I figured I might as well make a quick little video about this, and maybe some of you will find it interesting. Almost everyone uses base 10 to count things. That's usually written like that, base 10. And if you're used to seeing numbers written in base 10, writing base 10 like base 10 is completely normal and understandable. But the thing is, every base is base 10. By definition, in any given base, 10 is the way you write the base itself. What it means to be base 6 is that 10 means 6. When you're talking about different numbering systems, the fact that every base is base 10 makes this way of referring to bases extremely ambiguous. You need to specify what base you're using to talk about a given base, but since the base you're using is also base 10, you need to specify what base you're using to talk about that base. There's easy boring solutions to this. You could just write out the English name of the number in full, or have everyone agree that base 10 is the default. But that's not ideal, especially in the context where people are talking about using other bases as alternatives to base 10. What you'd like is a way of talking about bases in a way that is itself base neutral. And so, bases are given names, Latin-derived names typically. There's binary, ternary, quaternary, quinary, senary, septenary, octal, nonary, decimal, undecimal, duodecimal, and so on. These names are well established and commonly used. But the thing is, this still isn't really base neutral, at least not any more base neutral than just using English words for numbers. Like English, Latin uses base 10, and Latin names for numbers are rather decimal centric. For example, base 12, duodecimal, is a rather popular numbering system, and many people who like base 12 specifically dislike the name duodecimal, since it represents 12 as 2 plus 10. If you're trying to promote a numbering system where 12 is written as 10, calling 12 2 plus 10 doesn't feel right. For this exact reason, the name dozenal is commonly used instead, and it's a very good name. While etymologically it is technically still from something that at one point meant 2 plus 10, it's a much more fitting name for base 12 than duodecimal. So that's the reason I came up with my own system for naming bases a few years ago. I wanted to create a truly base-neutral method for referring to different numbering systems. It's a little bit quirky and not exactly the most elegant possible system, but I'm still happy with it, and I think it's a lot of fun. For bases where the existing Latin name isn't super explicitly decimal, their names can just still be from Latin. This includes all the bases up to 10, plus vigesimal for base 20 and centesimal for base 100. There's also a few where instead of the more traditional Latin name, I went with an alternative that I think is easier to understand, specifically trinary instead of ternary for base 3, and sexagesimal and septimal instead of senary and septenary for bases 6 and 7. Sexagesimal for base 6 in particular is one that I feel very strongly about. As you may know, base 6 is my personal favorite numbering system, and I really don't like the name senary for it. Unless you're already familiar with the intricacies of Latin number words, senary just doesn't sound like it has much to do with the number 6, nor does it really sound like it's the same type of word as binary or decimal. What it sounds like is scenery, a completely unrelated word that just happens to be spelled kinda similarly. And like, the last thing I want is for people to hear me talking about base 6 and think I'm actually talking about something completely unrelated. So that's why I call it sexagesimal instead. On top of that set of Latin-y names, the system also incorporates a couple names for bases that are already well known, namely dozenal for base 12 and hex for base 16. Hex is short for hexadecimal, a mixed Greek-Latin name that's very base 10, but the shorter name hex is a commonly used alternative that's just base neutral enough to fit in with this system. I also incorporated the name niftimal for base 36. This is from the gnome word nif, meaning 36, which is also used in my English language implementation of sexagesimal as the word for 36. Niftimal also happens to sound a bit like the word nifty, which is very fun. As I'll talk about soon, the core of this base naming system uses factorization, and as such, prime numbers are pretty important to it. So the final set of root names are used specifically for prime numbered bases. Base 11 is elevenary, obviously from the English word 11. Base 13 is bakersdozenal, as in a baker's dozen. And finally, base 17, a base which would be very impractical to use, is called suboptimal. Some people have pointed out that this name kinda sounds like it's saying that base 18 is the optimal base, which isn't the intention, but oh well. Anyway, as I was saying, outside of these ones that get their own simple root names, bases are named according to factorization. Naming numbering systems according to factorization is really useful, because what factors a base has can tell you a lot about its properties. Like, 2 and 5 are easy numbers to deal with in decimal, because 10 is divisible by 2 and 5. So, the first one that doesn't get its own root name is base 14, right after Baker's decimal. 14 is 2 times 7, so it's called biseptimal. You use the prefix bi to multiply a base by 2. Then base 15, 3 times 5, is triquinary, with tri meaning times 3. Great. So then there's hex, then suboptimal, then base 18. So 18 is 2 times 3 times 3. So you could call it bitritrinary, or you could call it 2 times 9, binonary. So since numbers can be factorized in multiple ways, there needs to be some way of figuring out which way you're supposed to do it. The solution I came up with is that you want to factorize the number into whatever factors are closest together, and put the smaller one first. So for 18, that's 3 times 6, so it's trisexymal. Next is base 19, which is a prime base. All smaller prime bases got their own roots, but there needs to be some way of deriving names for prime bases that are arbitrarily large. So what you do is you take the base one below it, then add the prefix un to mean plus one. So base 19 is untrisexymal. This might seem like a pretty arbitrary way to do it, and of course it is, all of this is arbitrary, but the benefit of naming prime bases after the factorization of the number one below them is that just like how a base's factors determine some of their properties, the factors of the number right below a base also determine some of the base's properties. For example, in decimal, while 2 and 5 are the most convenient numbers to deal with, 3 is also pretty convenient, and that's because it's a factor of 9, one less than 10. Next is 20, if bigesimal gets its own root. Then there's 21, triseptimal, 3 times 7, 22, bilevenary, 2 times 11, 23, unbilevenary, prime base, so it's 1 plus 2 times 11. Then 24 can be factored in a few different ways, but the one with the factors closest together is 4 times 6, so it's tetrasexymal, with tetra for times 4. Now's a good time, I think, to talk about the rest of the multiplicative prefixes, since I think you get the point. So every root name has a corresponding prefix. In general, these prefixes are from ancient Greek, like how hexadecimal combines both Greek and Latin number words together. Some of them aren't, though, like bi for 2 is a Latin thing. But yeah, bi is 2, tri is 3, tetra is 4, penta is 5, hexa is 6, hepta is 7, octo is 8, enna is 9, deca is 10, leva is 11, doza is 12, baker is 13, tesser is 16, mal is 17, icosi is 20, theta is 36, and hecto is 100. Another thing that makes naming bases according to their factors a useful thing to do is that when you're dealing with a really large base, it's somewhat impractical to actually have unique symbols and names for every single digit. I talked about this in one of the videos I did with Artifexian about number systems, but one solution to this problem is mixed radix. This means that the factor that determines the value of each position in a positional notation relative to adjacent positions isn't always the same. The go-to example for how this works is a digital clock, where some digits are 10 times the value of the digit to the right, but others are 6 times the value of the digit to the right. This is using base 6 and base 10 together as an intuitive way to use base 60 without actually needing 60 distinct digits. And since in my system bases are named according to their factorization, the name itself tells you which radices you can mix together. Following the algorithm, the canonical factorization for 60 is 6 times 10, the exact pair of radices used by digital clocks. So we just take base 10, decimal, and add the multiplicative prefix for 6, hexa, and we get the name hexadecimal. Wait, okay, so the problem we've just run into is that if you add a multiplicative prefix to decimal, it'll sound like you're using the traditional base naming system to talk about a completely different base. That's pretty confusing, so to avoid that, when you put a prefix before decimal, it becomes jesimal instead. So base 60 is hexagesimal, not hexadecimal. The other base that's different when there's a prefix before it is BIKERSDOZENAL. While this is a very good name that I like a lot, it can be a bit cumbersome and awkward to add a prefix to it. So when there's a prefix, BIKERSDOZENAL gets shortened to just KERSDOZENAL. So for example, the Excel column numbering system, base 26, 2 baker's dozen, is called BIKERSDOZENAL. Now for prime numbers. As before, these multiplicative prefixes are derived from the factorization of the number one less than the given prime number. Instead of un, you use the Greek-derived hen to mean plus one. So the multiplicative prefix form of untrisexymal is hentrihexa. However, this has the risk of being ambiguous. For instance, what would base 646 be called? It factorizes as 19 times 34. 34 is itself 2 times 17, so base 34 is bisuboptimal. Adding the multiplicative prefix for 19, hentrihexa, we get hentrihexa bisuboptimal. But while we know that the hen means to add 1 to some portion of the prefix before suboptimal, it's unclear exactly which part. While you could figure it out by looking at the different possibilities and seeing that only one of them follows all of the rules of this system, you shouldn't have to do that. You could rearrange the roots of this name to make something easier to understand, as in by hen trihexa suboptimal, but there's no guarantee that you'd always be able to do that, and it's an inelegant solution either way. So what you actually do is you add something to the end of a big prime multiplicative prefix. Having spoken parentheses like this is a kinda unnatural thing to do, so to make it as painless as possible, the close bracket particle is sna, which is very fun to say. The prefix for 19 is hen trihexa sna. You could, in theory, have a system for working out when this close bracket particle is actually necessary, but I think just always using it no matter what is fine. And that's almost everything. There's a couple more minor rules for optimizing stuff. As I said before, what you do when you're factorizing a number is you go with whatever two factors are closest together. Usually, those two factors will themselves need to be broken down, and you just do that recursively. So like 98 is 2 times 7 times 7, but it's factorized as 7 times 14, and 14 is 2 times 7, so base 98 is heptabiseptimal. Okay, but now let's say you wanted to use something like base 600. 600 is 24 times 25. 24 is 4 times 6, tetrahexadecimal, and 25 is 5 times 5, pentaquinary. So base 600 should be tetrahexapentaquinary. But the thing is, that name is way longer than it really needs to be. Why bother calling it 4 times 6 times 5 times 5 when this system has a specific root word for 4 times 5 times 5? Just call it 6 times 100, hexacentesimal. So what you actually do when selecting how to factorize a number is first try to minimize the number of roots you need to use, then pick the factors that are closest together. So even though 24 and 25 are right next to each other, the fact that 6 and 100 both can be expressed with single roots in this system means that that's prioritized. There's also some rules for dealing with vowel sequences that show up when one root that ends with a vowel is followed by another root that starts with a vowel. Here's the whole table for what to do with those. All of this stuff is designed so that, in theory, you could, for any given number, work out its name in this system by hand, but I also have made stuff that automatically figures out these names. Outside of this set of roots, there's a few extra ones that extend the range of this system to include more types of number. While the smallest base that's really functional is binary, base 1 still kinda works, and it's called unary. Base 0 can also be described in theoretical terms, but it would be literally impossible to use in any capacity. Nevertheless, it's called nullary by this system. This extends the range of numbers that work in this system to include all natural numbers. Negative bases can also sometimes be useful. So they have names generated using the prefix nega, following the established convention of negabinary and negadecimal for bases negative 2 and negative 10. This extends the range of numbers that work in this system to include all integers. Now, outside of the domain of bases that are sometimes useful, there's non-integer bases. These are incorporated using the prefix vot. Vot is used for the reciprocal of any integer base. For example, vot decimal is base 1/10. As you might have guessed, this is a reference to the language Vatgil. In Vatgil, numbers are represented in decimal but with their digits read backwards. This could be interpreted as Vatgil using base 1/10, hence vot decimal. These vot bases can then have the usual multiplicative prefixes added to them to represent any rational number base. So like base 2/3 is bivot trinary. Finally, there are the suffixes nary and imal. These suffixes can be added to the names of any number, with nary used for numbers less than 6 and imal used for numbers greater than 6, which makes it so that this system can work with any number which can be named. And that is the full system. There's definitely some parts that are kinda awkward to use, and it's not exactly the most mathematically elegant notation, but I still kinda like it. There's definitely some things I think I would change if I were to go back and remake this system from the ground up now, but I'm still happy with it. Now, one thing you've definitely noticed is just how long these names can get. The reason people who commonly use base 16 call it hex isn't so it can have its own base neutral name, it's because hexadecimal is just too long to say every time. So to go along with this base naming system, I've also come up with a system for abbreviating these base names. Unlike the base naming system itself, this is not designed to be an algorithm a human could do by hand. I haven't really described anywhere how exactly this thing works, so to close out this video, I'll do that here. Broadly speaking, this algorithm cycles through every possible abbreviation for the given base and picks whichever one it encounters first that doesn't conflict with the abbreviation for any smaller base. And here is exactly how it does that. First, it checks if the number it's given is a positive integer. Anything else is outside of the scope of what this algorithm is supposed to work with, so if it's not a positive integer, it just stops here. If it is a positive integer, it then looks up if the abbreviation for this particular base has already been saved to memory, since it would be a waste of time to calculate it again. Next, it figures out the given base's name using the process I've been describing throughout this video. It then rewrites that to be in all caps and removes any spaces or apostrophes, specifically so that BIKERSDOZENAL and the like don't get abbreviations that include non-letter characters. Next, it removes any vowels that appear in the name outside of the first three letters. The letter Y at the end of many base names is not removed at this step, even though it's a vowel. The reason for doing this is that vowels that appear later in these base names aren't that distinctive, and including them in an abbreviation wouldn't result in the most intuitive abbreviations. The string, which will be the final abbreviation, is created, by default just being the first three letters of the base name, which we already had to figure out in that initial vowel removal process. Also, an integer K is initialized to zero here. One more number to start keeping track of is the current target length for the abbreviation, ABVLEN, which is set to 3. We are now ready for the main loop of the algorithm. First, check if the current abbreviation is used by any smaller base. If it's not, we're done and can move on. Otherwise, keep going. Now, we take that number k and convert it to binary. We can now use this binary number and our trimmed base name to generate an abbreviation. You take the binary number with its bits ordered from least to most significant and line them up with the string you're abbreviating, with that least significant bit lined up with the second character in the string. Then, for each bit, if that bit is 1, you include the corresponding character in the abbreviation. For the first character, the one that doesn't line up with any bit, that one is just always included. Next, we take that abbreviation and check if its length is abvlin, the length we currently want the abbreviation to be. Yeah, this part is pretty inefficient. What I should have done when I made this all those years ago is have it check if it'll be the right length before doing all that working out and actually generating the abbreviation. This wastes a lot of time. Oh, right, one more case to worry about. If it turns out that k is too big for that process of lining up the binary number with the string you're abbreviating to work, then we add 1 to abvlin and reset k to 0. For some reason, which might have just been a mistake, the way it checks if k is too big for this actually says it's too big if there's a 1 corresponding to the final character in the string. So because of that, these abbreviations just never include the final letter of the base name. I legitimately don't remember if that's intentional or not. It probably wasn't. Anyway, now that we have our abbreviation, we add 1 to k, then go back to the top of the loop. Is this abbreviation used by any smaller base? If not, we've found the abbreviation. If it is, we now find the abbreviation corresponding to the new value of k. Finally, now that we have our abbreviation, once we finally have our abbreviation and exit the loop, we store it into that hash map so we can look it up later, then return it. So that's how abbreviations are generated using this pretty messy code I wrote a long time ago. I went through and checked for every base up to base 10,000 hectocentesimal just to get some stats on how short these abbreviations are. Of those, 29.55% were 3 letters long, 68.49% were 4 letters long, and the remaining 1.96% were 5 letters long, which I think is a pretty good result. And also, even though the majority in that particular range were 4 letters long, the smallest base that needs 4 letters is bakerpentanonary, base 585, abbreviated as BAKR. The bases people would actually consider using are way smaller than that, and they all get nice 3-letter abbreviations. And also, bases that do get 3-letter abbreviations are found throughout the whole range of numbers I checked, all the way up to EVC for ennalevuncentesimal, base 9999. And there's 3-letter abbreviations for names as long as the 35-letter long hen-by-hen-believus-nesne-heptatriquinary for base 4935, which gets comfortably abbreviated as HVQ. HVQ is the most efficient abbreviation in the range I checked, but the least efficient is base 16. Hex. Since hex is already 3 letters long, and since these abbreviations can't be shorter than 3 letters, its abbreviation is the only one which isn't any shorter than the thing it's abbreviating. If you exclude 3-letter abbreviations, no abbreviation within the range was any worse than 1/3 the length of the full name for the base, seen with FETN for base 6948, fetundozahex, and HECTC for base 10,000, hectocentesimal. While this system for generating abbreviations is very fun and does in fact create effective shorthand names for different bases, a major issue with it is that there's no way of working out what base a given abbreviation refers to. The other thing is that my code for this is just really inefficient and has lots of room for optimization. It has a tendency to get stuck for a really long time whenever it has to do an abbreviation that's more than 4 letters long. Anyway, that's pretty much it. I wasn't kidding before when I said I was working on like 5 other videos right now, so look forward to at least one of those in the coming weeks.